This morning we want you to look with us at the fourth chapter of the Gospel of Luke, beginning with verse 1, as we study the temptation of Jesus Christ. Luke 4:1, "And Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil for 40 days. And in those days he ate nothing, and when they were over, he hungered. And the devil said unto him, If you are the Son of God, command this stone that it be made bread. And Jesus answered him, saying, It is written, that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. And the devil took him up into a high mountain and showed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, All this power will I give you, and the glory of it, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will give it. And if you will bow down and worship me, it will all be yours. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. And he brought him to Jerusalem and set him on a pinnacle of the temple. And he said unto him, If you are the Son of God, cast yourself down from here. For it is written, He shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee. And in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time you dash your foot against a stone. And Jesus answering said unto him, It is said, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And when the devil had ended all the temptation, he departed from him for a season. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee. And there went out a fame of him through all the region round about." Here we read Luke's account of the temptation of Jesus Christ. Every one of us experience temptation. And every one of us have fallen to temptation. There's not one single person here today who can stand and declare to the congregation, I have never once in my entire life yielded to the temptation of the enemy. We've all known what it is to be tempted. We all know what it is to fall in temptation. Now, Jesus was tempted in order that he might be able to understand us and our failings when we are tempted. In Hebrews, it tells us of our great high priest, who in all points was tempted like we are tempted, in order that he might be able to help those who are in temptation. Now, there was a reason why Jesus was tempted. The reason why we are tempted is different. God has allowed Satan the freedom to tempt us in order that God might prove the depth of our love and devotion to him. It's very easy for people to mouth endearing terms to God or endearing words. Oh, God, I love you. I love you with all of my heart. Oh, God, I love you more than anything else. And it's so easy to avow in words our love for God, but how genuine is that love? God can only know how genuine the love is by testing it, by allowing Satan to tempt us. You see, when God created us, God had in his mind loving fellowship with man. God desired to receive love from man. He desired to give and to receive love. God desired to have a close communion and fellowship with man. But he wanted that man to love him in a meaningful way, and he wanted to know that it was a true, meaningful love. And in order that God might receive a true, meaningful love from man, he created man with the capacity of choice, so that I can choose to love God or I can choose to hate God if I so desire, or I can choose to be nothing. But it is my choice. I don't have to love God. He doesn't force me to fellowship with him. If I fellowship with him, it is an act of my will. I have chosen to walk in fellowship with God. I have chosen to obey the commands of God. I have chosen to express my love for God. I've chosen to love him and to serve him. But it's my matter of choice. But in order that my choice be meaningful, there must then be something to choose, but the alternative must be attractive. If the alternative is not attractive, then really that choice means nothing at all. So temptation is always a very desirable and a very attracting thing to me. If it were not desirable and attracting, it wouldn't be temptation. It wouldn't bother me at all. I said, forget it, man. Don't want that. And so temptation has to be attractive. It has to be alluring, or else it really isn't temptation. So God allows Satan to bring before me very alluring, attracting things. Things that I desire, things that I feel I would really love to have, in order that my love for him might truly be tested, that God might know how genuine is my avowal of love to him. He doesn't want me to be like the fellow who called up his girlfriend and said, "Oh, honey, I love you so much. I wish I could express to you how much I loved you. You mean more to me than anything else in the whole world. I love you so much that if somehow you were in England, I would dive in at New York, and I would swim across the Atlantic just to be by your side. I love you so much that if you were on the moon, I would attempt to fly to the moon just to be near you. And by the way, I'm coming over tonight if it doesn't rain." Words are cheap. I can avow my love for God. But when the test comes, do I really love him? God wants to know. And so he allows that temptation. Here's a field filled with weeds and briars, thorns, thistles. And God says to me, "Chuck, if you will walk with me through this field, over the hill on the other side, there is a fabulously beautiful garden. And when we get to that garden, we can have a beautiful, eternal relationship of love with each other. Walk with me through the field. I'll go before you and I'll make the path. You just follow me and walk with me. The rewards are so beautiful when we get to the other side." Satan says, "Hey, Chuck, here's a beautiful field of roses and a nice path through it. It's easy, it's straight, it's broad. Why walk through the weeds and the thorns to get to the garden? You can enter into the garden right here. No weeds, no thorns, no sacrifice, no problem. You can enjoy the beauty and the glory of the garden right now without walking through the briars and the weeds. The Lord says, Chuck, that path through the rose garden will lead to disaster and heartache. Follow me through the more difficult path, but I promise in the end, the rewards will be well worth it. Now, at this point, I must decide, who am I going to believe? Am I going to believe what God says to me, the Word of God, or am I going to believe what Satan is saying to me? God is saying, this is a path of self-sacrifice. It's not an easy path, but the rewards are so beautiful. Satan is saying, hey, this is a beautiful path. It's an easy path. You don't have to wait for the rewards down the road, which you don't even really know are there or not. All you know is he tells you they are there. But you can have it right now. Fulfillment of all your desires. Right here. Temptation is attractive. It's alluring. It looks good. It's desirable. And he holds it out and encourages me to walk in his path. Now, when Satan came to Jesus, even as he comes to us, the attack was against a threefold part of my nature. In 1 John we read, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world, for he who has the love of the world in his heart doesn't have the love of the Father. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life is of the world and not of the Father. So it speaks about these three characteristics of my nature: the lust of my flesh, the lust of my eyes, and the pride of life, which belong to the system of the world and are not really of the Father, but are of the world. So when Satan comes to me, his appeal is, first of all, to the lust of my flesh. Now, there is nothing at all wrong with the desires of my flesh in and of themselves. They were created there by God. God had a reason for creating these drives, these desires of my flesh. In order to survive, I need air. So God has created the air drive. In order to survive, I need moisture. So God has created the thirst drive. In order to survive, my body needs fuel, so God has created the hunger drive. In order that the human race might continue, God has created the sex drive. And in and of themselves, intrinsically, in these drives, there is nothing evil, there is nothing wrong, they are created there by God, and each one serve an important purpose and plan in our lives and in the procreation of the human race. Now, these drives can become very strong. If I'm deprived of air for any period of time, that drive becomes extremely strong. If I am lacking moisture in my body, I'm out in the desert and it's hot and it's dry, and my body begins to dehydrate, that thirst drive becomes so extremely strong and powerful, it almost overwhelms me. And each of these drives can become a very powerful, strong force. But God has not only created these drives, but He has also created the proper environment and manner in which these drives can be satisfied and fulfilled. Now, what Satan does is takes advantage of the drive and say, look, there are other ways of fulfilling that. They're more exciting. Rather than just breathing pure, clear air, you can put some substances in that air that you're sniffing, and it can give you some wild experiences. Look, rather than just satisfying that thirst with just a glass of pure water, you can take some alcohol and other substances and drink it, and you can satisfy that thirst drive, but in the same token, you can get a euphoric feeling and you can feel great, you know, like there's nothing wrong. And so it is possible to abuse these very drives that God has created by using them in an improper way or seeking to fulfill them in an improper way. So God has created the sex drive, but God has also created the right and proper environment where this drive might find fulfillment. And God said, for this cause shall a man leave his mother and father, and he shall cleave to his wife, and they two shall become one flesh. And God has created that environment for the fulfilling of this drive in order that there might be a beautiful family base and a secure base for the children to grow up and to become strong and healthy emotionally and physically and spiritually in this family-centered base. But Satan takes the drive and says, look, you can actually find greater fulfillment, greater excitement, a greater thrill by fulfilling this desire with another experience. Why should you commit yourself to one woman all your life when there are so many women out there? And he begins to hold up the allurement, the enticement. And with some people, he begins to twist it even further, because once you start allowing that twist, it's amazing how far that thing can get all twisted out of order. And so men begin to lose the natural affection for women, begin to be attracted to each other. And then, as we see it in our society today, attracted to children and even worse. Our society is now degrading into bestiality, where these normal, good, God-given drives are twisted and turned, perverted. And Satan takes these normal, God-given drives, holds up an alternative that looks to be attractive. And he says, look, immediate fulfillment, the excitement, the thrill that you can have. You don't have to take God's path. You don't have to walk that straight and narrow. You can have immediate fulfillment now. It's over here. It's in this experience. It's in this relationship. Here's where you'll be happy. Here's where you'll find, you know, the answers. Here's where you'll be euphoric and all. And he leads us aside from God's path, using and appealing to this lust of my flesh. When Satan came to Eve in the garden and tempted her to eat of that tree of which God said, you shall not eat, the Bible records that Eve saw that it was good for food. He appealed to the lust of her flesh. Oh, that tastes so good. And as he began to describe how it tasted, she began to salivate, just, ooh, you know. Good for food. When he came to Jesus to tempt Jesus, the same area, the lust of the flesh. For Jesus had been fasting for 40 days and was now hungry. And Satan said, look, why don't you take that stone and turn it into bread? Why don't you use your divine gifts, your divine power, in order to satisfy your own fleshly needs? Satan, even today, so often is taking those men that God has gifted and enticing them to prostitute the gifts of God for their own profit, to fulfill their own pleasures or their own needs. Secondly, Satan appeals to the lust of our eyes. The eye has been called the gate to the soul. It is one of the gates to the soul. There are five basic gates into our consciousness that men have studied. There's a sixth that is an important gate that men haven't done much study in. There is that sixth sense. But the five physical senses, one spiritual sense, but the five physical senses, of course, the eye is an important gate. The mouth, the taste, another gate. The nose, the olfactory senses, another gate. The ear, another gate, and the touch. All of these are feeding information to your brain. All of these are feeding information that is being stored in your brain. Your brain is like a computer, a memory bank. And you are feeding into that computer through sight, through touch, through what you hear and all. You're feeding the memory bank of your computer. And the Bible warns us that whatsoever a man sows, that will he also reap. And if you're sowing to your flesh, you're going to, of the flesh, reap corruption. And so the second area that Satan appeals to is that eye gate feeding into the brain, the lust of the eye. Only again, he carries it beyond the norm, the natural, into the unnatural, that it might feed to the flesh and bring forth inordinate activities from your life. As you feed to the flesh and then begin to reap of the flesh. We today are surrounded by all kinds of attractive stimulus or stimuli. Billboards. Advertisements are designed to appeal to the lust of the eye, to draw your attention. And it is hard to escape seeing that which would be attractive or alluring to the eye. Look how the whole society is based upon making a person more eye-appealing to others. I mean, just think about everything you do to create eye appeal. And so here we are, everyone vying for this eye appeal bit. And some become extremely appealing to the eye. The lust of the eyes. It begins to feed into that computer. Now, Satan appealed to Eve. She saw that the fruit was pleasant to the eye. It said that when he came to Jesus, he showed to him the kingdoms of the world. He showed him Caesar sitting on the throne. He showed all of those servants bowing to Caesar as they brought him the delicacies and as he ate of these delicacies that were brought to him. The beautiful court and the opulence and the luxury that surrounded the Caesar showed to him the kingdoms of the world and their glory. The eye gate. It was appealing. It was attractive. It was desirable. And then Satan comes to us with that pride of life, that desire to be admired, that desire to have people look up to you with awe and respect, to Eve, he appealed to that pride of life. Look, Eve, if you just eat of this, it's going to make you as wise as God. You're going to be just like God, Eve. Think of that. Like God, the pride of life. He appealed to it. To Jesus, when he took him to the pinnacle of the temple and said, "Now jump." The whole idea was, he will give his angels charge over you. You will land softly down there on the pavement in the midst of all of those people. And when they see you jumping from here and just landing softly in their midst, oh, how they're going to look at you and how they're going to come up with wide eyes and mouth open and say, "Oh, you know, you must be the one." Demonstrate for them. If you're the Son of God, demonstrate it to them. Let them stand in awe of you to worship you. Jump! You don't have to worry. And he appealed to that pride of life, that desire to be something big, something admired by others. And Jesus said unto him, "It is said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God." Now, in every temptation, there is always the suggestion that you don't have to take God's path of sacrifice and self-denial to find fulfillment. You can actually find fulfillment immediately if you'll turn from God's path. And this basically is what Satan was suggesting to Jesus when he offered to him the kingdoms of the world. Look, why have you come? You're the Son of God. Why did you come? You came in order that you might reign as king over the earth. When Pilate said to Jesus, "Art thou then a king?" Jesus said, "To this end was I born, for this cause I came into the world." He came into the world that he might establish the kingdom of God and that he might sit upon the throne of David and to rule and to reign in righteousness from henceforth forever. He came that he might reign as King of kings and Lord of lords. But on the path to that crown and to that throne, there was a cross. And so God's path was by way of self-sacrifice, denying of self. God's way was the cross, taking up the cross. And Satan is saying, "Look, who wants to hang on a cross? Who wants to sacrifice and who wants to give up himself to something like that? look, I'll tell you what. Don't take God's path. Don't take God's way, because what you've come for, I'll give to you right now. You don't have to take that painful path of the cross, but you can have the immediate fulfillment of your purpose and of your goals right now. All you have to do is just bow down and worship me, and I'll give to you the kingdoms of the world because they're mine and I can give them. Look, I put Caesar on the throne. I'll take him off and put you on the throne, and you can be sitting there in Caesar's place. It's mine, and I dispense it. And so all you have to do, bow down and worship me. You don't have to go to the cross. And so Satan comes to us and says, now look, God's path is self-sacrifice. God calls upon you to deny yourself. You don't have to. You can find fulfillment right now. Just indulge yourself. Just go ahead. And I will give to you right now that fulfillment, that happiness, that joy, that excitement you're looking for. I'll give it to you right now. You don't have to take God's path of sacrifice and the cross. But you can have immediate fulfillment. The immediate fulfillment lies in this relationship over here. It lies in this experience over here. Look, and he holds it up and he dangles it, and oh, it looks very attractive. Isn't that what I'm desiring anyhow? Isn't that what I'm looking for? Just real love, real, you know, fulfillment. Oh, all right, you know, and it looks so attractive. Because it's immediate fulfillment without the cross, without the sacrifice, without walking that path to the cross. Temptation always looks good because it has the promise of immediate fulfillment without the cross. Jesus resisted every temptation. The secret of his power was twofold. We notice immediately that in each temptation, he answered it with the word of God. When Satan said, command that stone to be made bread, use your power to feed your flesh, Jesus said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word from the mouth of God. When Satan said, I'll give to you the kingdoms of the world right now if you'll just bow down and worship me, Jesus said, it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God and him only. When Satan said to him, jump down, show your power. If you're the Son of God, reveal it to them. For he will give his angels charge over thee. Jesus said, it is said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And with each of those temptations that Satan held before Jesus, Jesus answered them with the word. David said, thy word have I hid in my heart, O Lord, that I might not sin against you. How important it is that we have programmed into our hearts the word of God. Because when that temptation comes, then the old computer goes through and poof, up pops the scripture, you know. The power, the strength against that temptation that Satan is holding before us. But the word of God alone is not enough to give me victory over temptation. Eve used the word of God. When Satan was tempting her to eat the fruit, God, she said, the Lord said, if we eat it, we will die. she used the word. But Satan challenged the word. He said, "Oh, you surely won't die." And now Eve has a problem. Will I believe God's word or Satan's word? For he has challenged the word of God. She used the word, but it was now challenged. And unfortunately for us, Eve believed the word of Satan and ate the fruit, but the word of God proved to be true, and she died. And death passed upon all men, for all die. The word of God is powerful. It is the sword of the Spirit. It is a powerful defense against temptation, but in and of itself, not enough. You need more. What was the secret of the victory of Jesus over temptation? In verse 1, "And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit." The power over temptation comes not only by the Word of God alone, but by the Holy Spirit working through the Word of God within my heart. It is necessary that we also know that power of the Holy Spirit that makes the Word of God alive. And through the Spirit and through the Word, you can have victory over temptations. Through the Spirit and through the Word, you can be freed from the power of sin that holds you as the result of your yielding to temptation. For have you ever noticed that when you yield to temptation, that very thing that promised you freedom is the very thing that brought you into bondage? These people that advocate free love and freedom and all are the most enslaved people in the world, because they're enslaved to their own appetites and lusts over which they have absolutely no control. They advocate all of this looseness in the name of freedom, free living. But it's a lie, because it's the most enslaved experience that a person can have when you become a slave to your own lust and desires. And many of you today find yourself trapped in situations that you'd love to get out of. Back along the path some way, you took a wrong turn. Satan held it up. It looked good. Immediate fulfillment. Oh, this is great. And you took that turn. And you missed the mark. The Bible says, "Let no man, when he is tempted, say, 'Oh, God is tempting me,' because..." He said, God doesn't tempt men with the evil, but a man is tempted when he is drawn away by his own lust and enticed. And this lust, when it really is conceived, its fruit is sin. But it is also slavery, because you then become the victim and the slave of your own appetites. But through the power of the Holy Spirit, you can be set free. Through the power of God's Spirit and the Word of God, you can be delivered today so that you can walk the path with God. Oh, you'll have testings, sure. It's not an easy path. It's a field filled with briars and thorns and thistles. But the Lord goes before to tramp down the path to make the way. And if you just stick close to Him, you'll find out that He smooths it out. But the promise the glorious promise of that eternal dwelling place with Him in His kingdom, sharing His love forever, is worth any sacrifice that I might have to endure for the present. There is a cross always before the crown. There is no crown without the cross. Satan offers you one without the cross, but that's a lie. I encourage you to take God's path. Believe God's word. Walk with Him. Shall we pray? Father, we rejoice in the opportunities of proving our love. Knowing that the trial of our faith is more precious than gold, though oftentimes it perishes when tried in the fire. Oh God, we want to be purified of the dross. Let your Spirit do His work. God, we want to walk with you. Help us, Lord. Give us strength. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we might be able to withstand those temptations that Satan may place in our path. In Jesus' name, amen. It is quite possible that some of you today feel trapped by your situations, and indeed, you are. But the Lord wants to help you if you just give Him the chance. He said, I will set you free. Satan says, oh no, you can never be free. I've got you now. This is going to be something you're going to have to live with the rest of your life. Learn to live with it, man, because I've got you now. And the Lord says, no, I'll set you free. And you've got to believe either God's word or Satan's word. See, that's the choice we have to make that choice so many times. Am I going to believe the word of God or Satan's lie? Today, the Lord has promised to set you free. Just give Him the chance. I would encourage you to go back to the prayer room, and the pastors will be back there to pray with you, that you might know the power of God and His Holy Spirit working in your heart and life, bringing you victories through Jesus Christ. And may you know that power of the Spirit and the power of the Word and the fellowship of the Spirit and the glorious peace of Jesus Christ just filling your heart and life this week as you walk with Him. And may your walk be enriched as you walk that path with the Lord. May your fellowship with Him just grow day by day until your life is just so filled with God's love that as Satan would seek to draw you aside or to entice you into a side path, that you'll just have such strength and power by the Spirit that you'll be able to resist every temptation and live in victory with Jesus. God bless you. In Jesus' name.